यूनिट 6 इनपुट आउटपुट फाइल इनपुट एंड आउटपुट फाइल सिस्टम पार्ट 1। सो फर्स्ट इज इनपुट आउटपुट डिवाइसेस। So first we will see the overview of this. So the control of the devices connected to the computer is a major aspect of operating system design. There is a wide variety of input-output devices. These devices vary widely in their function and speed. It is difficult for any operating system to develop a general consistent solution for these input-output devices. There is no single method to control these input-output devices. Every operating system separates methods dealing with input-output devices from the rest of operating system. The interaction with input-output devices is increasingly being standardized both from the software and hardware side. The device drivers are increasingly becoming popular. The device drivers present a uniform device access interface to the input-output subsystem. The device drivers provide the standard interface between input-output devices and operating system. So the external device that engage in input-output with computer system can be grouped into three categories. So human reachable, machine reachable and communication. Now the human reachable means it is suitable for communicating with the computer user. So printers, terminals, video display, keyboard, mouse. Machine reachable, suitable for communicating with electronic equipment, disk drivers, USB keys, sensors and controllers. Now the communication, it is suitable for communicating with remote device, modems and digital line drivers. So the principle of input-output hardware. A computer uses many kind of the devices. The devices can be put in three categories. The storage devices such as disk and tapes, the transmission devices such as modem, network cards, etc. The human interface devices such as screen, mouse, keyboard, etc. The input-output devices communicate with a computer system through a port. The devices are connected through a bus and a bus is set of the wires. The interaction through a bus is through a set of messages. A controller is a collection of electronic circuit that can operate a port, a bus or a device. The operating system is concerned about programming input-output devices. While writing an application program, we look at the interface presented to the software through commands accepted by the hardware. Error reporting by the device should be considered with care. So the devices differ in number of areas such as data rate, that is there may be the difference of magnitude between the data transfer rate. Application, the use to which a device is put has an influence on the software. And the complexity of the control, that is the effect on the operating system, is filtered by the complexity of input-output module that control the device. Unit of transfer is data may be transferred as a stream of byte or the characters or in large blocks. Data representation, the different data encoding schemes are used by different devices. And error conditions, the nature of the error, the way in which they are reported, their consequences and available range of responses differ from one device to another. So this diagram shows the typical input-output device, typical input-output device data rate. On x-axis it is data rate in BPS, bits per second, and on y-axis there is a keyboard. Different devices such as keyboard, mouse, modem, floppy disk, laser printer, scanner, optical disk, ethernet, hard disk, graphic display, एंड गीगाबिट इथरनेट। So the input-output devices can be put into two categories, the block devices and the character devices. Block devices means a block device store the information in fixed size blocks. Each block has a unique address. The basic unit of read-write in block device is a block. Each block can be accessed independently. The disk is a block addressable device. Any block can be accessed in a disk irrespective of the current position of read-write head. Similarly, a tape or a CD is a block device. And character device. A character device accepts or delivers a stream of characters. There is no concept of blocking in character device. The terminals, printers, network interfaces, keyboards, etc. are character devices. Some devices like clocks do not fit into any of the two categories. Clocks simply generate interrupts at well-defined intervals. So the organization of input-output functions. There are three techniques for performing input-output: programmed input, interrupt-driven input, and direct memory access. Before that, we will see the device controller. So the device controller consists of electronic component. It interacts both with the device and the system bus. Mostly, the interface between the controller and the device is a standard interface. An operating system interacts with the controller and it does not interact directly with the device. A controller has several registers for data and control signal. The processor communicates with the controller by reading and writing the data in these registers. The device control register can be either a memory mapped or input-output mapped. Some systems use both the technique. In general, a controller has four registers: data in register, data out register, status register, and control register. So data in register means data from the device is stored in the in this register, and this data is for the host computer. Data out means here data to be sent to the device is written in this register, and data is written by the host computer. Status register means this register can be read by the host computer to know the status of the device, and it could be busy, read, and error condition. The control register means this register is written by the host computer to start a command or to change the mode of the device. The operating system perform input output by writing a commands into the control register. For example, the hard disk controller may accept a different command such as read, write, seek, format, etc. So, now we will see the three techniques for performing input-output. So, the first one is programmed input-output. Here, the processor issues an input-output command on behalf of a process to an input-output module. That process then busy waits for the operation to be completed before proceeding. So CPU is a general purpose processor and it is capable of addressing all needs of an input-output device. If data transfer operations are completely controlled by the CPU, that is, the CPU executes a program that initiates, directs, and terminates the input-output operation. computer is said to be using a programmed input-output. This type of input-output control can be implemented without additional hardware, but since input-output devices are very slow, CPU will be wasting a lot of its time in trivial input-output operations. Next is interrupt-driven input-output. So, the processor issues an input-output command on behalf of process. If non-blocking, then processor continue to execute instruction from the process that issued the input-output command. And if blocking, then the next instruction the processor execute is from the OS, which will put the current process in a blocked state and schedule another process. So, this technique, it can considerably improve the CPU performance, and this technique is called interrupt-driven input-output. In interrupt-driven technique, the CPU issues the input-output command to the input-output device and starts executing the other program. When input-output operation is complete, this device interrupts CPU by informing the CPU that input-output has finished. CPU then may proceed with the execution of original program. In input-output driven mode, the CPU can handle several input-output activities in parallel. So in both programmed and interrupt driven input-output, CPU is responsible for either sending or receiving of data. A slight increase in hardware enables an input-output device to transfer a block of data to and from memory without intervention of CPU. This mode of interaction is called direct memory access, that is DMA. So this module controls the exchange of data between main memory and input-output module. So there are three commonly used input-output techniques: DMA, that is programmed input-output, interrupt-driven input-output, and direct memory access. So program input-output is useful method for computers where hardware costs need to be minimized. The entire input-output is handled by CPU with the help of a small software without any additional hardware. It is based on the concept of busy waiting. Before input-output operation is performed, the CPU checks the status of input-output devices. If input-output device is not ready, then CPU simply wait in a loop for the input-output device to become ready. The CPU performs the steps such as, first it read the input-output device status bit. Second, the test the status bit to determine if the device is ready to begin data transfer operation. And third one, if the device is not ready, then return to step 1, otherwise proceed with the data transfer. During the interval, device is not ready, CPU simply wastes its time until the device becomes ready. So the major interrupt-driven input-output, the major drawback of programmed input-output is busy waiting. This is a major drawback. So the speed of the input-output device is much slower in comparison to that of the CPU. Since in programmed input-output, the CPU has to repeatedly check whether a device is free, the performance of CPU goes down. One solution could be CPU switches to some other program without waiting for the input-output device to complete or to become free. When the device becomes free, it informs back the CPU through a mechanism known as interrupt. The interrupt-driven input-output mechanism for transferring a block of data. So, a CPU issues a read command to input-output device and then switches to some other program. CPU may be working on different program. Once input-output device is ready with the data in its data register, the input-output device signals an interrupt to the CPU. When interrupt from the input-output device occurs, it suspends execution of the current program, reads data from the port, and then resumes execution of the suspended program. Now we will see the comparison between programmed and interrupt-driven input-output. The programmed input-output can be implemented with the help of software without any additional hardware cost, whereas in interrupt device-driven, additional hardware is required to handle the interrupt. The programmed input-output is simple to implement, and it is used in low-end system where cost is very important factor. Most of the contemporary computer system are based on interrupt driven input output. The programmed input output is based on busy waiting. CPU keeps checking the status of input output device. Since input output devices are very slow, CPU will have to waste a lot of its time waiting for the device to become ready. In interrupt driven input output, CPU switches to some other program without waiting for the input output device to complete or to become free. Only one input-output activity can be handled using programmed input-output, whereas multiple input-output activities can be carried out in overlap fashion with interrupt-driven input-output. So the next is the interrupt processing. The interrupts can be generated by various sources, both internal and external. An interrupt or the execution causes the CPU to temporarily transfer the control from its current program to another program and interrupt handler. So next is this is the input output technique, where the input output to memory transfer through processor, no interrupt programmed input, and use of interrupt in interrupt driven, also direct input to memory transfer in direct memory access. Next is the evolution of input output function. So first is the processor directly control a peripheral device. Second, a controller or input output module is added. Third, same configuration as step 2, but now interrupts are employed. Fourth, the input output module is given direct control of memory via DMA. Fifth one, the input-output module is enhanced to become a separate processor with a specialized instruction set tailored for input-output. The input-output module has a local memory of its own and is in fact a computer in its own right. Next is the typical DMA block diagram. So this block diagram, it consists of the data count, data register, address register, control logic. Control logic has different pins. Both interrupt-driven input-output and program-driven input-output require involvement of CPU for data transfer. The CPU can be better utilized for the program execution. Input-output activities are slow, and involvement of the CPU will not have a desired effect on system performance. In addition, the speed with which the CPU can test and service input-output devices limit the input-output data transfer rate. When CPU is involved in data transfer, it uses the system bus twice, during memory to CPU transfer and during CPU to input-output transfer. The DMA increases the speed of input-output transfer by eliminating the role played by CPU in such operation. When large amount of data is to be transferred from CPU, a DMA module can be used. The DMA operate in following way. When an input-output is requested, the CPU instructs the DMA module about the operation by providing the information. So which operation, that is read or write, to be performed. the address of input-output device to be used, the starting location in memory where information will be read or written, the number of words to be written or read. So the DMA module transfer the requested block byte by byte directly to the memory without intervention of the CPU. On completion of the request, the DMA module sends an interrupt signal to the CPU. In DMA mode, the CPU intervention is limited at the beginning and end of transfer. While DMA is busy in data transfer, the CPU can execute another program. So, this figure shows the typical DMA block diagram. The programmer visible registers along with the control signal are shown here. The DMA transfer proceeds as follows. So first is CPU load the DMA register data count and address register with number of bytes to be transferred and starting memory location respectively. When the DMA controller is ready to transmit or receive the data, it activates the DMA request line to the CPU. The CPU wait for the next DMA breakpoint. The concept of breakpoint is shown in this diagram. The CPU now leaves the control of system bus and the activities DMA acknowledges. When DMA control is ready to transmit or receive the data, it activates. It now transfers the data directly to or from the main memory. After word is transferred, data count register and address registers are updated. If data count register has not reached zero, but the input-output device is not ready to send or receive the data, DMA controller releases the system bus to CPU by deactivating DMA request line. If the data count register is decremented to zero, the DMA controller finally relinquishes the control of the system bus. It may also send an interrupt signal to the CPU to indicate an end of data transfer. So, the DMA is equipped with two channels. The register needed to store the memory address and the word and so on are duplicated so that one set can be used with each device. A connection is also provided for each channel between the DMA controller and one of the input-output devices. So, whether a read or write is requested using read or write, the control line between the processor and the DMA module, the address of the input-output involve the communication, the data line, the starting locating in memory to read from or write, to communicated on data line and store the DME. The number of word to be read or write again communicated via the data line and stored in the data count register. So next is the design objective. The efficiency and generality. In efficiency, there are 4 points, that is major effort in input-output design. These are important because input-output operating often form a bottleneck. The most input-output devices are extremely slow compared with the main memory and the processor, and the area that has received the most attention is disk input output. The desirable to handle all devices in a uniform manner. It applies to the way process view input output device and the way the operating system manages input output device and operations. Next, the diversity of the devices makes it difficult to achieve true generality and use a hierarchical modular approach to the design of the input-output function. Next is the hierarchical design. The function of the operating system should be separated according to their complexity, their characteristic time scale, and their level of abstraction. It leads to an organization of the operating system into a series of layers. Each layer performs a related subset of the function required of the operating system. The layer should be defined so that the changes in one layer do not require changes in another layer. So this diagram shows the model of input-output organization. It consists of user program, logical input-output, device input-output, scheduling and control. Then in second, it has additional communication architecture, then device input-output and scheduling and control. And in the last one, it has a directory management, file system, physical organization, device input-output, scheduling and control, and finally it is to the hardware. So first is the local peripheral device, second is the communication part, and third one is the file system. So this diagram shows the model of input-output organization. So operating system design issue, the design objective. There are two objectives are paramount in designing input-output facility. The efficiency is important because input-output operations offer from a bottleneck in computer system. One way to tackle this problem is multi-programming, and the major objective is generality, the interest of simplicity and freedom from errors. So the logical structure of input-output function, the logical input-output, device input-output, and scheduling and control. The logical input-output module deals with the devices as logical resource and not concerned the details of controlling the device. The device input-output, the required operating and detailed buffered character scheduling and control, the actual queuing and scheduling of input-output operating occurs at this layer. The DMA data transfer mode. The data can be transferred in several different types under DMA control. So some of them are DMA block transfer, cycle stealing mode, and transparent DMA. The DMA block transfer in this type, a block of data of arbitrary length can be transferred in a single burst. This DMA mode is needed for secondary memories like disk drives, where data transmission cannot be stopped or slowed without the loss of data. The block DMA transfer supports the fastest input-output transfer, but it can make the CPU idle for a long period. The CPU will not be able to execute the program as the control of the burst lies with DMA. In cycle stealing mode, the DMA controller is allowed to use the system burst to transfer one word of data at a time, after which it must return the control of the burst to the CPU. In fully loaded DMA, both CPU and DMA use the system burst alternately. So during first, third, and fifth cycle, the CPU is required to have a control of system burst to access the memory. If these cycles are given to DMA, the effective execution time of instruction will increase. In the worst case, the instruction may require 8 cycles. If the DMA is allowed to steal cycle when the CPU is performing the decode instruction or the execute instruction cycles, both the CPU and DMA will be able to operate concurrently. In transparent DMA, it is allowed to steal only those cycles when the CPU is not using the system bus. The CPU does not require to have a control of system bus during decode instruction or execute instruction phase. So the input-output software is organized as a series of layers. The lowermost layer interacts with the hardware. The uppermost layer provides a nice and friendly interface to the user. The input-output software makes the user interaction with the device independent of the device. The devices are handled by the operating system. The input-output error are handled by the input-output software. Interrupts are handled by the input-output software. User program can be written with the K, with the ease if input-output operation are blocking. For example, if read command, after read command, the program is automatically suspended until the data are available in the buffer. So the scheduling of input-output device is handled by the input-output software. Many devices like this can be used by many users at the same time. Many devices are dedicated to a particular user. The devices like printer have to be dedicated to a single user until that user is finished. The input-output software must handle both shared and dedicated devices in a way that avoids a problem. The goals of the input-output software can be achieved by structuring the input-output software in 4-layer: interrupt handler, device driver, device management, device independent operating system software, and user level software. So interrupt handler, the interrupt driven input output mechanism is very efficient. CPU switches to some other program without waiting for the input-output device to complete or to become free. When device becomes free, it informs back the CPU through a mechanism known as interrupt. The device driver is a piece of input-output software that handles all device-dependent tasks. Device drivers accept abstract requests from the device-independent software above it and convert it into device-dependent commands. The device-independent input-output software refers to that of the set of programs which provide a device-independent interface to the user. The basic function of this software is to perform functions common to all devices. It provides a uniform interface to the user-level software. The basic function of device-independent software are uniform interfacing for device driver, device naming, device protection, providing device-independent block size, buffering, allocating and releasing dedicated device, and error repeating. In program written in high level language, input output operation are provided through library function. So this is all about the input and output file, interrupt handler, DMA. In next lecture, we will see the buffering. Block-oriented, single buffer, double buffer, utility of this, positioning the read-write heads, and so on.